So, can Christians be without love? The Bible says that if we walk with the Spirit, we should keep in step with the Spirit. So, in today's video, we're going to talk about love and Christianity and how they're related. Now, if it's your first time joining us on Daily Bro with Dylan, I'm your host, Dylan. And real quick, if you could, please consider subscribing and sharing this with a friend. So let's dive right into it. Like I said in the intro, the Bible says that if we walk with the Spirit, that we should also keep in step with the Spirit. In Galatians 5, verse 16 through 21, it says, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God." And see, today, a lot of churches just do not preach about sin anymore. But we have to. We have to teach the Bible in a balanced way. Now, listen to this next part. In Galatians 5, verse 22 through 26, it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other." So let's talk about the first fruit of the Spirit here, and that is love. And Paul talks about love in this verse as an agape love. Now, what does agape love mean? Well, agape love means it's unconditional and sacrificial type of love, and that you would do anything out of that type of love. It's the type of love that means that you choose to love someone even when you don't feel like it. And so understand this, it's not a feeling. It doesn't just mean to love someone when you feel like it. And as a newborn Christian, we now love because we made the decision to love even when our flesh doesn't feel like it. And we're able to do so because of being led by the Holy Spirit. And that is the kind of love that God works in us and through us in our day-to-day actions. It's how that love of God is able to reach other people. And without this agape love, we are nothing. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1 through 3 says, "If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship, that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing." And see, this is a big issue for those Christians who have been a Christian forever, you know, the legalistic style Christians, the ones that have their theologies down and they read cover to cover and they like to argue and quarrel with someone just because they're insistent on winning for themselves instead of winning a soul for Christ. And the problem is they don't even realize it. And they can unfortunately be so full of anger and pride. And a lot of them are blind to their own fault. Just like the Pharisees had a problem with. They didn't even realize that they lacked the most important thing in the entire law, and that is love. And yes, you have to speak the truth, but there's a way to do it with love and through the Spirit. Don't argue and quarrel to win an argument for yourself or for your flesh. Now we read further in verse 4 through 7 of 1 Corinthians 13. "Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. And now I think it's just super important that we examine ourselves daily and every time that we talk. Am I still acting in the flesh? Or am I being led by the Spirit? Am I acting in the Spirit? Am I full of love and building people up? Or am I taking pleasure in tearing people down? And when verse 7 says that you have to bear all things, it doesn't mean that you should just let everyone walk all over you. No, we stand for the truth and righteousness in a bold way, but with love, doing it with love. And it means when people hurt you, bear it and forgive them. Because how can you expect God to forgive you, yet you won't forgive others? We should always view others with love. And our fight isn't against each other as human beings. Our fight is against the spiritual world, the evil spiritual world. And see, God wants everybody with him in heaven. And the person that you're trying to talk to about God, even as arrogant as you think they are, as closed-minded and hard-hearted as you think they are, yes, God wants them to. So try to start seeing all people, including your enemies, the way God would see them. God would look at those people with love and wanting them to be another soul with him in paradise. Now let's continue. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 8. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. And let's stop here real quick. A lot of people just focus on prophecy or, oh, I can speak in tongues. Can you speak in tongues? And to me, it's just very strange to focus on all these gifts. But the most important of that is love. That is why you should chase after love as a Christian. Now let's continue in verse 9. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And among these three remain faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Wow, what a beautiful set of verses there, right? That we just read. And right there at the end. But what is the greatest of those? Love. You know, it's so sad, the world that we live in. So many people don't even understand what true love really even is anymore. We tend to act in our sinful nature. Even as a reborn Christian, we sometimes fall. But we need to learn, because God the Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit shows and tells us in the scriptures what love truly is. And now we can know how to love God with everything, with all that we are. But also, in return, we can know how to love other people with that agape love, the unconditional sacrificial love. In 1 John 4, verse 7 through 8, we read, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love." So, do you understand now? Do you understand how important love is? Because God himself is love. We only love because he first loved us. And even as sinners, God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for us on the cross because of how much he loves us. So don't fight and argue, and by doing so, push people away from the cross just because they don't agree with you. It's more damaging to act full of pride and to deem yourself Christian, representing God, but hypocritically ignore God's command to love everyone. Jesus said himself in Matthew 22, verse 37 through 40, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and prophets hang on these two commandments." Now, if you're a reborn Christian, you have the Holy Spirit with you and are sealed with the promise of eternal life, you must stay in step with the Spirit, meaning to abide in God always, because then you will automatically produce the fruits of the Spirit, and of that being love. And God didn't ask, He commanded this, and Jesus confirmed it. In John 13, verse 34 through 35, Jesus said, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." So in conclusion, do you love your enemies? I mean it. I mean, really, do you love them so much that you would be willing to die, lay down your life, even for your enemies? Well, you're thinking, no way, right? But see, now let's look at it from this perspective. That's what Jesus did for you, for me, and for the world. He laid down his life for sinners, people that mocked him, people that spit on him, people that continue to put him down, people that put his people down. He died for all of us. We all have that same gift of eternal life waiting for us. We just have to be there to grab it. Because see, Jesus died for even your enemies, not just you. So pick up your cross and follow Jesus today. And each day that you pick up your cross in the morning and you follow Jesus, it's going to get easier and easier to love, because your mind starts to change. You start to see people differently when you are reborn Christian. And remember that our fight is not against one another. The devil is the one that wants to cause division. But through Christ, we can have unity. So change your perspective today and view one another as God views all of us. Thank you for joining me today. If you have any future suggestions for videos, drop it in the comments below. Thank you for all the support, and I will see you guys again next time.